and move on to our next topic. All three candidates for governor have said that they would like to find a way to build a new Viking stadium. There have been different plans laid out to do just that. First of all, do you support using taxpayer dollars to fund a future stadium development for the Minnesota Vikings? Dale Helm, we'll start with you on this.
Unfortunately, no, I do not, and I'd like to explain why. I cannot see subsidizing for a new Viking stadium. And don't get me wrong, the Minnesota Vikings have done wonderful for the state. They are a great asset, there is no doubt. But right now, people have lost jobs. Right now, people are out of their homes. Right now, people are trying to be able to support for their families again. I cannot in good conscience support subsidizing for a Viking stadium when we need to be taking care of those deeper issues here at home. And that's where my stand on the Viking stadium is at this time.
Okay. Tom Tilbury, your opportunity, same question. Do you support using taxpayer dollars to fund a future stadium development for the Minnesota Vikings?
At this point, I do not. But one of the things I'd like to point out that I've struggled with this particular issue. Number one, back when I was running in 2006, had Anoka County been given the spot, this Viking stadium would have already been built. One of the things that we look at, I look at the jobs that it can provide, and that's what I struggle with because those are good jobs that are available. We've seen that with the Twin Stadium, we've seen it with TCF Stadium. However, I do have difficulty supporting something that is only going to be here 8 games in a year. And if you're lucky to make the playoffs, I have to have more benefit for that. Mm-hmm. I have to have something, and I really would be encouraged if the Viking leadership would step up and at least explain what happened with the Anoka County piece, because there was a few dollars that were invested in this that I think they need to talk about before even coming for my vote.
Okay. Dale Helm, your chance for a rebuttal if you have anything with this question.
Well, I think Mr. Tilbury and I are coming from the same place on this piece. You know, when we talk about spending, certainly in a hard economy like this one, we have to be asking ourselves, what is a taxpayer getting for their dollar? And it has to be managed well. So I would say that I agree with Mr. Tilbury, and you know, we have to be really thinking about what we're doing.
Okay, and your opportunity for a rebuttal.
I would just like to add again, the good jobs that we need to have is something we have to look at into. But I do necessarily agree that if we're going to look at this particular piece, we got to think of the age of our schools and the school buildings that we're having our kids go to, and what does that say for our priorities?
Okay. All right, let's move on to our next question because you both just mentioned it, and it's jobs. Job creation. Minnesota has seen lower unemployment rates than the rest of the country, and while that is good, there are still people out of work and there are still people hurting. Mm-hmm. What tangible ideas do you want to bring forward at the state legislature that would help spur increased job creation? And Tom Tilbury, we'll start with you on this question.
One of the things that we had an opportunity to do was I voted for a bonding bill. Bonding bill every 2 years happens. It happens, it's happened in the history of Minnesota. It brings jobs that were needed. We were ready, shovel ready for all of these particular pieces, and that could bring people union jobs when you're talking about electricians being on the bench and we're talking about construction workers and so on. These particular tasks were there. Now, we want to also keep our bond rating, so we have to keep it within a certain limit. However, I feel we left about $300,000 or $300 million, I would say, on the table. $300 million that was vetoed out by the governor. And I would like to say, if you look at the history of what the governor vetoed out of those packages, if it said DFL behind their name, their project was discontinued. That's our voters. That's people that vote me in. They're my constituents. They suffered because of the governor's decision.
Thank you. Same question to you now, Dale Helm. What are some tangible ideas that you want to bring forward at the state legislature that would help spur increased job creation?
Well, this is one of the major differences between Mr. Tilbury and I, because I understand that jobs are not created by spending in the government. What Mr. Tilbury is talking about is with a $5 billion deficit looming in front of them, they chose to vote first for a $1.2 billion and then later for a $1.1 billion increased spending plan. The issue that I have with that is it's the private sector that creates jobs. Keynesian economics did not work for Woodrow Wilson. They did not work for FDR. They did not work for Jimmy Carter. They're not working for Obama. and they're not going to work today. What has worked has been tax incentives for small business, release of mandates that are outdated and outmoded so that we can work and make a more business-friendly environment here in Minnesota. The business says we've seen tens of thousands of jobs lost in Minnesota over the last years. We need to reverse that.
Thank you both for your answers. Now a chance for rebuttals. Tom Tilby, you're first.
Right. I'd like to make it interesting that Representative Maury Lanning, who happens to be a Republican, he decided that he wanted to have the same thing, cutting mandates. So I served with him and worked with him on that. And his fellow Republicans did not even vote it in to get it off of the floor.
Thank you for that answer. And chance for a re-rebuttal, Dale Helm.
Sure. I'd like to make a point. I'm not here as a Republican. I do not care what the letter is behind the person's name. If there was a Republican legislator that did not work with Mr. Tilbury trying to honestly and sincerely remove mandates, to me that's an issue. And I do think that that needs to change in Minnesota. We need to have the old approach, Americans first, Minnesotans second, local communities third. Okay. I believe that.
Thank you. Let's move on to, you just mentioned local communities, let's move on to our next topic, and Dale Helm, you'll be first on this. How do you see yourself working with leaders at the county level, at the municipal level, at a time where some might say that relationships between the state government and those local levels of government have become more strained because of things being cut or taken away at the state level that local leaders might have been used to in the past? How will you work with those leaders?
Well, I think one of the things that's very important is that when you're running for this kind of office, it's why are you running? Now, I'm running to be a public servant, and to me, that means having not only listening to the citizens of the district, but listening to the other levels of government that you work with. State representative is a critical liaison between cities and counties. I personally feel that every voice is welcome at the table. Every idea should be put forward. And let the best solution win. I am not about who gets the credit. I am not about one party over another party. I want to make something clear to the citizens in the district. I'm not running for a party, a political agenda, or some kind of personal initiative. I am running this campaign because I want to be a good public servant and do a number of the things that we have seen and we've discussed over the years and said, when will a common sense candidate come forward and do that?
Same question to you, Tom Tilbury. How do you see yourself working with leaders at county and municipal levels?
It's important to be at the table and be listening to their concerns. And we attended many different meetings and talked about with them many times. The fact, though, is we're also responsible for funding a portion of their particular budgets. And where the trust breaks down is when all of a sudden you cut and pull the rug out from under people. And you say, oh, sorry, we have to cut our budgets. We can't afford to pay you. Perfect example of that was even with our schools where we said, we're going to delay payments. We've done it twice this year, delaying payments. How do we do that? We're asking 300 and some school districts to go out and loan money, get a loan for it. That's incredible. Also, this local government aid that we have that's set by a formula that's been in for years, that we've tried to tweak in many different ways. We cannot just pull the rug out from under our fellow citizens with concerns that have to deal with safety and all types of other things that we have in our communities.
Okay. Chance for rebuttals, Dale Helm.
Absolutely. Well, first I'd like to talk about the schools that he mentioned. One of the things that I'm very concerned about is the fact that twice Mr. Tilbury voted to try to remove your right to vote yes or no for extension of school levies. That to me is an issue. The second thing is the LGA. The LGA was originally set up to be a support system for critical services to the cities. Now over half the state no longer has that, and it's become a padding of the budget.
Thank you for your rebuttal on that. Tom Tilbury, your chance for rebuttal.
I need to rebut two areas that he brought up. One is the LGA piece. It's interesting, Spring Lake Park was not eligible for any LGA under this current piece, and North Oaks was. That was something I had to work with and had to write an amendment to fix. The second thing that he brought up was the school districts piece. And the school districts, as far as levies and so on, managing and operating those levies are very important to do.
On that topic there. Let's move on to my final question for you for the evening. And oftentimes citizens hear from candidates only during a campaign. How will you effectively communicate with your constituents throughout the entire your entire term in office? Tom Tilbury, you're first.
I've had a practice of sending out legislative updates all the time. And on a weekly basis when we're in the session, that has been something that we've done all the time. Anyone contacts our office, we have that out to them, email or by other means. So I'm always available for the questions. Also sending out surveys to determine what is important in our district and letting people respond to that. And so that has helped guide the way that I choose to vote on different things. And to just also remember, well, I'm going to go back to that piece with the school levy piece. It's interesting that cities and counties do not have to go before the voters to ask for any type of funding. We only ask that our schools do it. And I look at it as we need to clean that up, because I don't disagree. Voters need to be able to do it. But let's take a look at all three of those systems before we just label schools as having that problem.
Okay. Same question to you now, Dale Helm. How will you effectively communicate with your constituents throughout your term in office?
Well, first off, I've been starting a new relationship at the door knocking with people, making it clear that I will have an open door, making it clear that I want to hear from them, spending time, not just a quick, hi, will you vote for me, but spending anywhere up to an hour talking to a voter to get his important concerns. This will continue. I had the same relationship in the military. I have this relationship now with my employees. And I will be about, through my website, communicating to them as well as the official government site. But I do have to say very quickly, first off, cities do vote on whether or not they're taxed. And there have been motions, matter of fact, in Fridley, to try to have special elections to make it harder for more of the citizens to vote. And going back to the school levies, I think it's still critical to understand that these votes were to remove your right to say yes or no. That is your right as a voter. That's your right as a citizen. It should not be removed. And I think that's important for you to know.
Okay. Opportunity for a rebuttal, Tom Tilbury.
Your right as a voter is definitely there. It's not in question. You also vote for every single member on the council, commissioners, and you also vote for your school board.
Okay. And final rebuttal here, Dale Helm.
The thing I think is interesting when we're talking about the area of education, and I also heard Mr. Tilbury mention unions, I would like to make it clear that every opportunity there has been to, I'm going to go back to his piece on communicating. Very quickly, I just wanted to say that when I've talked to people at the door or the people that are around him, I apologize. Thank you.
All right. Let's move on to kind of our final question, but it's a question that's not going to come from me. It's a question that you're going to ask to each other.